And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1 p.m. Up next, Project Censored.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. Today's program, updates on Fukushima, how nuclear power is an ongoing danger to our health and the environment. We're joined for the hour by journalist and author Libby Halevi, host of the international news magazine Nuclear Hot Seat, and author activist Kimberly Roberson, director of the Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network. On the show today, we'll share the latest facts regarding the Fukushima nuclear disaster in Japan, its effects on the West Coast and throughout the U.S., as well as steps you can take to help safeguard you and your family's health. Stay tuned for a Fukushima update on the Project Censored Show. Listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. Today's program, updates on Fukushima, how nuclear power is an ongoing danger to our health and the environment. We have two guests for the hour, and many of you, of course, know, because you tune into Pacifica Radio, that this is where you can hear alternative information and material that you won't hear a lot of in the corporate news media. And in the last several weeks, we've heard an awful lot about things like Ebola and other things that purportedly pose threats to us. But there are other things going on around the world that are probably more significant in terms of the long-term potential threat they pose, not just to Americans, but to all of us around the world. And today we're going to be talking about these issues. We want to share the latest facts regarding the Fukushima nuclear disaster that happened over 3 years ago in Japan. We want to talk about its effects on the West Coast. There have been recent reports of radiation from Fukushima off the West Coast. And we also want to talk about some positive things, some proactive things, what we can do to help safeguard us from this type of radioactive exposure, which may in fact be increasing as the years go on. So here is Peter Phillips to introduce today's guests. Peter?
Labibi Halevi is a journalist and writer who was 1 mile from the nuclear accident at Three Mile Island when it happened. Since Fukushima in 2011, she has produced and hosted Nuclear Hot Seat, a weekly international news magazine on all things anti-nuclear, which is downloaded in 6 continents and received as many as 500,000 hits in a week. Libby authored Yes, I Glow in the Dark, 1 mile from Three Mile Island to Fukushima and Beyond, a nuclear memoir available on ebooks at Amazon.com, and leads radiation awareness and protection talks, seminars and workshops on practical ways to minimize nuclear radiation's negative impacts on your health and your family. Libby, are you there?
Yes, I am. Thank you very much, Peter and Mickey.
Thank you for being on, and we'd like to ask you, really, tell us about your magazine that you're producing, the show that you download, the Nuclear Hot Seat. That's a weekly, and who are some of the guests, and what have you been doing with that?
Well, Nuclear Hot Seat is an audio magazine, and as I begin to talk about things today, I just want people to know that there's going to be a lot of challenging information for people to wrap their heads around, especially if they've not been following the nuclear issue, which most people have not. But with the empowering information, we're going to help them understand both how to safeguard health and how to get involved in local actions to fight back against nuclear. This is what I cover on the show. I've been doing it since 3 months after Fukushima, and every week it is nuclear news from a slightly John Stewart-esque angle. I also do interviews with people who are involved in fighting back against nuclear from all angles. I've had conversations with Dr. Helen Caldicott, Arnie Gunderson, people involved who are scientists, epidemiologists, and activists on the ground, not only around the country, but around the world. And this goes on every week. I also have a feature. I hope this isn't too rude for your listeners, but it's called Numb Nuts of the Week for Nuclear Boneheadedness, and it's always about someplace where the nuclear industry just gets it wrong.
Well, Libby, this is Mickey Huff on the Project Censored Show. Thanks so much for joining us today.
My pleasure.
I'm afraid sometimes we're only left to devices like dark humor when we are dealing with this, because, you know, Project Censored is no stranger to covering nuclear issues from weapons to energy. We've covered it in our books for years. Brian Covert, who's in Japan, has written pieces for us on Fukushima, and we've interviewed several of the people that you even just mentioned on this. I just wanted to give a thanks out here at the outset of the program today to Robert Manning, who's in studio with us. He helped us put together with you, and he's helped us in the past. So we thank Robert for his assistance and helping put together these kinds of programs. But you were just mentioning that, you know, what the nuclear industry gets wrong. Why don't you highlight for us just a few key but really, you know, even basic points where the nuclear industry is just completely wrong on whether it's nuclear and energy safety. We hear often that nuclear energy is a great way to get off of quote-unquote fossil fuels. Address a couple of those issues.
Thank you. First of all, making nuclear sound like it is carbon neutral is false. It has no place in a climate change conversation, and it is total disinformation. Realize that the nuclear industry makes a profit of approximately $1 million a day per reactor. So they've got a lot of money to put into PR campaigns, disinformation, and talking points that they put out all over the internet, Wikipedia, they get to newspapers, and so they're able to twist the conversation to their own ends. One of the worst of these is including nuclear in any kind of a carbon neutral conversation, because it is not neutral at all. If you follow the entire fuel cycle for nuclear, it includes mining, which leaves behind uranium tailings. There is the transport issue, because it has to be, all the materials have to be going over either our roads, which take them through cities, or on rail. There is the expense of building, of turning the uranium into fuel pellets, the expense and risk of building nuclear plants with carbon-intensive materials and equipment, and it takes a tremendous amount of petroleum and water in order to run a nuclear reactor. And that says nothing about the tons of radioactive, highly radioactive material that is left behind that we have no way of neutralizing and no way of safely storing until such time as it becomes radiologically neutral. Plutonium, which is the most dangerous material on the planet, is produced by every nuclear reactor in the spent, quote-unquote spent, fuel rods. And one millionth of a gram of plutonium, if you inhale it, will give you lung cancer. It is radiologically active for a half-life of 24,000 years, and it will take 20 half-life cycles for it to become neutral, meaning 480,000 years. So we're dealing with the creation of a long-term disastrous impact on health and safety for life on Earth in exchange for a little bit of what is the illusion of cheap energy, but is really very expensive.
Libby, Helen Caldicott writes and said on our show and has said many times that there's no safe level of nuclear radiation in the world. And you have certainly said that nuclear is bad for the environment and the climate and affects us all. The front pages of our papers have been talking about the plume of radioactivity that's now reaching the West Coast. They're saying it's very minor levels diluted down into the ocean, cesium-135, 137. But that's kind of a misunderstanding. Can you give us an update on Fukushima, what's really going on there, and what the huge dangers are?
Well, I'd like to address some of the points that you just made, because there's a tremendous amount of disinformation that has been woven into that story already. First of all, the plume of radiation that is coming over in the water is not the first plume that has hit the west coast of the United States, and indeed it has gone to the rest of the world. That was in the air from Fukushima that started hitting the west coast about 8 days after the accident began on March 11 of 2011. And that hit the entire west coast, but it was particularly concentrated from perhaps northern Oregon all the way up through British Columbia and then into Alaska. It was estimated by Arne Gundersen that if people in Tokyo were exposed to between 10 and 20 hot particles of radiation per day from Fukushima, that people in Seattle were exposed to 5 to 10 hot particles, meaning this is direct contamination from the nuclear reactor accident over there. In addition, there's the problem of rainouts because radiation got up into the jet stream. And any time it rains, when the jet stream is heavy overhead, raindrops form around particulate matter, which brings that down to Earth, which is why there were radiation spikes in places like St. Louis and Oklahoma and New England and elsewhere around the planet. As regards the radiation that has been found coming across in the Pacific, first of all, all they're measuring for is cesium, and there are other radionuclides as well, but cesium is the cheapest and the easiest to measure for. It cannot dilute. Radiation cannot dilute. The particles can get smaller, but it's not like a poison that gets less potent as it dilutes. Every molecule of radioactive material sets out the electrons, the particles that get thrown off from it, and every one of those are capable of penetrating cells. So it doesn't dilute and it doesn't go away. And cesium, with a half-life of 28.4 years, it's going to be around for just under 300 years. So what's coming across that way is just one way we have been hit with the radiation. As regards Fukushima, it's really important, Arne made this point, I just interviewed him for Nuclear Hot Seat this week, that we need to think of it not as a single accident, but as three accidents, because three reactors were involved, and that it has released more radiation to the air and water than Chernobyl ever did. It's the worst accident, the worst industrial accident the world has ever seen. And it has, the three reactors have melted down, they have melted through 8 inches of solid steel, and as regards China syndrome, we don't know if the core melted through the concrete below, but it doesn't matter because the problem is that it is in contact with groundwater, and the groundwater is taking that radiation, and that is what is leaking into the Pacific Ocean and will continue to, according to Arne, for anywhere from decades to hundreds of years into the future. This one's not going to go away, so it is an ongoing exposure that we are having.
Libby Halevi, journalist, writer, you were 1 mile away from the nuclear accident at Three Mile Island when that happened in 1979. And since Fukushima happened, you have been producing a program called Nuclear Hot Seat. That's nuclearhotseat.com. You know, you mentioned so many important points that there's hundreds of tons of radioactive water rushing into the Pacific Ocean every day. And, you know, Fukushima is an ongoing and unfolding and maybe unraveling catastrophe, and in the United States, again, it's that's yesterday's news. I mean, even after the election last week, Ebola, the great Ebola craze, right, that was sweeping the airwaves, even that seems to have disappeared, you know, into the rearview mirror. But Fukushima is something that's ongoing and very real. Can you give us a little bit of an update there, because there are certainly some new developments here just in the past week. Can you talk a little bit about those and the radiation off the West Coast?
Well, in terms of Fukushima, they managed to tear a hole in the cover they placed on Unit 1. This is TEPCO. That was supposed to hold the gases in and prevent them from going airborne. And so, of course, TEPCO says not much gas has been released. And compared to the original explosions, they're right. But compared to every operating reactor in the U.S., the releases are way off the charts. So that's being released. They said that they have removed all the fuel rods from Unit 4 to give the impression that they have saved us from the possibility of a fuel pool fire. But Arne Gundersen again said that once it, once 2 years have passed, the chance of a pool fire drops, and after 3 years, it's just about impossible to happen. So TEPCO is doing the steps that are the easiest for them to take and blowing up what the importance is, but they are completely ignoring the fact that units 1, 2, and 3 have cores, the corium, the hot fuel. They don't even know where it is. It's too radioactive to approach. And early in October, there were two different super typhoons that went through Japan, and they dropped between 6 and 10 inches of rain in a single day on Fukushima Daiichi. And at that time, radiation in the testing wells next to Unit 2 peaked from 800 to 900 times the radiation they'd had before, because everything on site washed into those wells. And those are not necessarily the most radioactive wells there. So, as Arnie said, it's going to bleed for decades, if not centuries.
Libby, there's been a number of nuclear accidents worldwide historically since we first started using nuclear weapons. There have been exposures and dropping of bombs and various accidents. This is kind of cumulative in the world, and it's ongoing. And does this, how impacting is this on our health?
That's something that Kimberly Roberson can speak to with great specificity. I'd like to raise for the listeners who are in your listening area the fact that in Northern California and on the West Coast, we are currently facing a number of very serious problems. The first one is Diablo Canyon, if I may, because it was designed in the 60s. It was poorly built. There are 13 earthquake faults in the vicinity of the reactors, and some are known to intersect. What that has is implications for the safety of the plant, because in an earthquake, there's a thing called ground motion that's not necessarily tied to Richter scale. And depending on how this happens, there could be a serious accident at the plant. And the NRC's own senior resident inspector at Diablo for 5 years, a man named Dr. Michael Peck, an employee of the NRC, said that at Diablo, there are components that are not in compliance with its operating license, and it should be shut down. And he gave his report to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and they sat on his findings. He even filed a specific report against them to try and get this information out, and it wasn't until the report was leaked to Friends of the Earth, and it was not leaked by Dr. Peck, but it was leaked by somebody else still employed there, that they finally went public with this information between September and October of this year. And finally, Diablo Canyon is out of compliance with its licensing basis, and at the same time, PG&E is applying for a 20-year extension beyond its 2024-2025 expiration of current license. It's insane to keep this going. And there is a lawsuit by Mothers for Peace, San Luis Obispo Mothers for Peace, against Diablo Canyon for all of these reasons. They actually have about 6 lawsuits going right now.
Wow, this is serious. Let's bring Kimberly Robinson in on this conversation. She's worked for the past 25 years in the field of environmental activism and then holistic nutrition. Kimberly Robinson has been involved with anti-nuclear and social justice campaigns at Sane Freeze, CalPERG, and Greenpeace USA. Her passion for natural health led to serving on the board of the National Association of Nutrition Professionals and as a founding vice president of the California chapter. She's lobbied for safe environmental and natural health policies on the state and federal level. Also, immediately after Fukushima, she wrote a petition calling for radiation monitoring of food, which led to the foundation of the Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network. Silence Deafening Fukushima Fallout, A Mother's Response is her first book. Kimberly, are you with us?
I am. Hello.
Well, I asked earlier, and they said ask you this question about the health impacts. Why don't you spin from there?
Well, the health impacts are why we, Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network, filed our citizen petition with the USDA, US FDA to lower cesium-134 and 137 in our food supply. And cesium, you know, I don't know where I should start with this, but we have the highest allowable levels for cesium in the world here in the United States. Japan has 100 becquerel per kilogram of cesium allowed in their food, and we have 1,200. That's a huge gap. I mean, what that means is that food from Japan can be sent over here to the U.S. totally legally for our consumption, and it's not allowed there. We don't really believe that they're able to keep to those levels there right now, but they're trying. And we should be trying to do much better, too. Cesium is the one that we've chosen on our petition because it gives off a very specific form of radiation, and it's more easily measured and identified than some of the others like plutonium-239 or strontium-90. And this in our food is what we're thinking right now is that it's widespread in the United States because we had this first radiation plume come over. Was it like March 18th of 2011 with the rainfall? And we had a very, very long rainy season that year. It's hard to imagine now, but it was raining well until June. And cesium, because of Chernobyl, we've learned a lot of lessons through the research of Bandashevsky and Yablokov. And we know that cesium accumulates in heart muscle and in thyroid tissue, and it greatly impacted the health of children in the Belarus region. So we know that it does bioaccumulate, and it can cause angina, it can cause diabetes, high blood pressure, and heart attacks. It's very serious.
We're speaking with Kimberly Roberson. She is one of the founding members of the Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network and author of Silence Deafening, Fukushima Fallout, A Mother's Response, her first book, silencedeafening.com. We're also joined by Libby Halevi. She is from nuclearhotseat.com. We've already been speaking with Libby, and we are now joined by Kimberly Roberson, and we're going to be joined by you for the rest of the hour. So we have a lot of time here to talk about these very important issues, updates on Fukushima, and how nuclear power is an ongoing danger to our health and the environment. On that tip, Kimberly, let's go back to you and your book, Silence Deafening, Fukushima Fallout, A Mother's Response. I think that's a really, that's a very important component there. And I'm going to go out on a limb and say that that's likely what led you to do the research here and write this book as a mother.
Absolutely. You know, I am a certified nutrition educator, and my background prior to that was working on radioactive waste issues, primarily with Greenpeace. I was involved with the Ward Valley campaign here in California, that proposed low-level radioactive waste dump in Southern California, and also on a campaign in Massachusetts where we were proving that decommissioned nuclear reactors were bound for dumps proposed such as Ward Valley, which really aren't just booties and gloves from the medical industry, as was told us. And I decided to go back to school, studied nutrition. I was in that field for about 10 years. And then my husband woke me up on the morning of March 11th, 2011 to tell me that this, you know, all hell was breaking loose in Japan. And our son had just turned 3. I had been home taking care of him, and I had been in kind of a blissful mommy bubble. I'll be the first to admit it. And boy, did that bubble burst that day, because immediately it really, I mean, I wouldn't say immediately. It took a few hours to sink in the magnitude.
You know, Kimberly, I just wanted to interject very quickly. I was in a very similar situation. We had our daughter was about 4, and my wife was pregnant at the time. So the alarm bells went off, and we started to try to research this too. Tell us a little more about the book.
Well, you know, I would stand at my kitchen window and just watch the rain. I mean, we were having a horrific, well, not horrific, but I mean, in a way it was. Our rainy season extended until June. It's hard to imagine now with our drought. But knowing what was happening, what was coming down in the rain, I was, you know, putting him in like super protective, you know, raincoat gear and only, you know, running him to the car when possible. Nobody was talking about it. I was like the lady in the store who was like looking for milk and water predated. You know, March.
Right. And Kimberly, UC Berkeley was doing some measurements, and they actually found some measurements of radiation that was coming down through the rain into the grass. Cows were eating it, and they found trace levels of it in milk just in Sonoma County in Northern California.
Isn't that the truth? And, you know, they actually had a total of, I think, 150 samples. Rainwater, groundwater, topsoil, very important. Milk, just pulled right from the shelves, like you were saying, lettuces, spinach, and all of the samples showed some form of radioactivity. Some of that cesium-134, which is a marker from Fukushima, 137, iodine-131, strontium-90, xenon, which was really, boy, that was an eye-opener. That's some of the worst that you can get. And they were very transparent with these findings on their website at Cal, the University of Berkeley Nuclear School of Engineers. So when I started talking to people who were forming FAN with me, we were very closely watching that data, and we were surprised. It was great. It was so transparent, and we had some meetings with Senator Boxer's office and Senator Feinstein's office, and we were able to take this information with us. And then now, if you were to go to their website, it has a kind of a feel-good video, very breezy. It talks about how they're still on it, they're still monitoring, but they're really not finding, you know, very much. But fortunately, ENE News and others have saved the screenshots, so there's a full archive at enenews.com.
Libby, let's go back to you. You were at Three Mile Island. You were within a mile of that accident. And can you tell us about that experience?
Well, it was life-changing. One of the things that never gets computed is the emotional stress that happens when one suddenly discovers that they're next to the one thing that they were told was never going to happen, which was a nuclear accident happening that released radiation. And we did our best to not pay attention to it for the first day. It was a medialist household, but I went out walking, as I've only recently discovered from some research. I was in the plume, and on the third day, I was alone in my friend's house. I was just visiting. I didn't live there at the time. And the announcement went down the middle of the street: stay inside, close your doors and windows, and do not go outside unless you absolutely have to. And at that point, I was completely isolated. I tried to phone out. The phones were not working because they were overloaded, because everybody was trying to call at the exact same time. I had no means of transportation. The house didn't have a basement to hide in. And at that time, I didn't know whether the thing could explode or not. So all the propaganda that I went through in the 1950s and the Cold War as what was going to happen to me because of the Russians and the bomb was about to come down on me, as far as I knew, from my own government from 1 mile away. And it led to a total change in my life. It stressed out my adrenals, both through post-traumatic stress, and we never did find out how much radiation was released there. And it basically threw me off track for years and years to come, even as I tried to ignore it. It wasn't until Fukushima happened that I, like, kicked back into awareness of the impact of Three Mile Island on my life, and the fact that the exhaustion that I had been going through, I tracked it back, and it started with the trauma from Three Mile Island and whatever exposure I had, and led to depleted adrenal glands. It's also the reason why I never had children, because I had been well-schooled in the Cold War as to what radiation could do to the body, especially the reproductive tract. And nobody could say how much radiation was released at Three Mile Island or what the danger was to me. So I made the proactive decision not to risk giving birth to a mutated child. I wasn't strong enough to deal with that possibility in my life.
Well, Libby Halevy, I was in Western Pennsylvania at the time. I was about 8 years old, but I remember vividly, you know, the Three Mile Island incident, and my father worked at a power plant outside of Pittsburgh, and
wow,
it was a really, I just, you know, I was young, but I remember it was a household topic, to be sure. And as we now know, you know, that was sort of the forerunner for Chernobyl, and that sort of tipped the scales in terms of nuclear industrial accidents, and now Fukushima. And I know people were reticent early on to make the connections with that. I mean, in other words, saying that Fukushima hadn't surpassed Chernobyl. But I believe, as you said earlier, that's not the case.
That's not the case. And I want to make the point that people say, that the nuclear industry likes to say, well, nobody died at Three Mile Island. But that's not the case. There's been a recent epidemiological study that takes actual health statistics from the area. And the highest level of thyroid cancer in the country is within a 50-mile radius of Three Mile Island. When it comes to Chernobyl, the official stats out by the nuclear industry is that only a handful of people died because they were first responders and they got hit with such high radiation. But we know from the compiled and translated work of over 5,000 reports that was done through the work of Dr. Alexei Yablokov, who was the nuclear advisor to Gorbachev in the USSR. He came up with the translation of the articles, which showed that there were probably 1 million extra deaths due to cancer because of exposure to the nuclear radiation, and that's not counting the birth defects that came down the line. Now, in Japan, we have information that has come person to person about, we know that there are over 100 diagnosed cases of thyroid cancer. We know that there are far more children that are being shown to have thyroid nodules already. This is 3 years out from the accident, which is when you would expect this to start showing up, 3 to 5 years. The problem being that doctors from the beginning have been under pressure to not mention radiation, not show any connection between radiation and what people are going through. No statistics are being collected. And as actually, we've just learned that there are doctors who are being told that they will lose their medical privileges if they say anything about radiation in connection with any illness that their patients are going through. So there's tremendous suppression, there's tremendous manipulation of the statistics so that there could be the appearance that there is no danger, when in truth there is tremendous danger, and Japan is, in my opinion, behaving in a genocidal manner towards its own future generations.
Well, let's be clear. This is censorship. I mean, this is a form of censorship. We know that the press was heavily censored about Fukushima in Japan after the incident. We know here in the United States that we have ag gag laws. In Pennsylvania, there were laws gagging doctors. They were prohibiting doctors from talking talking to their patients about fracking and fracking chemicals. So again, this is something that goes on. We know this is going on, and we need to uncensor it. We need to be talking about this far more. After this brief musical break, we'll be back with our guests, and we'll be talking more about updates on Fukushima, how nuclear power is an ongoing danger to our health and the environment. Stay with us. This is the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. On today's program, we're spending the hour talking about some updates on Fukushima, nuclear power, and ongoing dangers to our health and environment. We are joined by Libby Halevi. She is a journalist. She is an author. And we are also joined by Kimberly Roberson, also an author and activist. You can learn more about their work, about Libby's work, at nuclearhotseat.com. You can learn more about Kimberly and her book. It's silencedeafening.com. Of course, you can also find out about Kimberly's work at the Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network. I know they're on Facebook. You can also find out about them online. And Kimberly, we wanted to begin this segment of the program, the second half hour, by going to you and shifting gears a little bit. We just finished the first segment there and ending about how there's a lot of censorship around these issues, reticence to discuss these issues. In fact, there are people that are being threatened by speaking the truth about some of these issues, certainly around health effects, radiation levels, and so forth. But we wanted to shift gears a little bit, and of course we'll probably come back to some of this and talk about maybe some of the lawsuit issue with the Ronald Reagan sailors and some other things. But one of the things we wanted to get to this hour is what can we be doing about some of these issues? What are some proactive, positive steps that people can take to become more aware about these things? I know that there is a website called Rapt Awareness. RAPT awareness.com that helps in this regard. But Kimberly, can you talk to us a little bit about some things that people might be doing? Of course, educating themselves is one.
Well, thank you so much for that, and it really is great to have this opportunity to shed some light on this situation. I wanted to mention two things. One is the actions that we're taking are really twofold. We need to be active in making social change happen. We also need to be active in protecting our own families, obviously, in our communities. And the Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network, if I may just tell you about our citizen petition, back in 2013, March 12th, we filed, and it's a non-adversarial legal document. We filed it with the U.S. FDA. Our core groups are Citizens for Health out of Washington, D.C., Beyond Nuclear, also out of Washington, D.C., Ecological Options Network, or EON. And then we also had the help of some mothers who had fled Japan, had evacuated with their children. They were married to Japanese men. They're American citizens. They came back here just horrified to find that here what they were fleeing to, we have these outrageously high levels of radiation allowed in our food supply, set at 1,200 becquerel per kilogram. Now, a becquerel is one atomic disintegration per second. And as I mentioned earlier, the U.S. has a very high level, 12 times higher than Japan's. So can you imagine what they were feeling coming here only to find this? And So we got together, we wrote out this petition, we filed it. It's not cheap. It's kind of misleading to think of a citizen's petition. You know, people fundraise around this. We were fortunate to have the help of some attorneys who really went a long way to help us put this together. And what it basically is asking for is a significant reduction in the current allowable levels of cesium-134 and 137 in our food and nutritional supplements and pharmaceuticals. It's a broad piece as I said, it's a legal document. And currently, the direct interventional level, or the DIL in the U.S., is set at the 1,200 becquerel limit. So what we did was really thought long and hard about what we would ask for. And we asked the FDA to lower the limit to 5 becquerel and then to make it binding because, believe it or not, with this 1,200 becquerel per kilogram is just a recommendation. It's not even a binding limit. So what this means is that the FDA can do whatever they want and whenever they want and allowing whatever to come into our country. And now with the Trans-Pacific Partnership nearing finalizing, you know, who knows what's going to be coming in, much more than probably is now. And we're also asking to institute a widespread testing of food in the U.S. so that we can get some sort of idea not only what is contaminated so that people can avoid it, but also to establish a research database for people who are interested in studying the long-term effects of low-dose contamination of cesium, of radioactive cesium. It's a very complex issue, and I believe whole entire books have been written on cesium and how it bioaccumulates, or you know, it's very complex. So we need more research because a lot of it is still unclear. And what we really want to do is to know that we can track this radiation. And unbeknownst to us at the time, when we were deciding on this 5 becquerel per kilogram number, the IPPNW in Germany, the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War, were pretty much asking for the very same thing in the EU at 4 becquerels for cesium-134 and 137 combined for 8 altogether. So that was a real watershed moment for us to realize that this was an international movement that was forming and very empowering. And then on the other hand, how do we protect our families? Because EPA really can take their time. You know, the citizen petition is something that they are legally required to respond to. So far, we've received a letter saying thank you. We received this and we're considering it. Meanwhile, we're collecting comments on our website at www.ffan.us. You'll see a big button on the right side of the screen. If you represent an organization, click on that. If you're an individual, click on that one. It'll lead to some instructions and just how to leave a comment. And then, you know, we really need people to get involved with this. It's not going to change otherwise. And we have a companion petition at moveon.org. We call it the Bye Bye Becquerels petition, basically saying the same thing, and it just takes a few seconds to sign. And both are on our website. And then the other prong of this two-pronged effort is how do we protect our families at home? And, you know, this is where the nutrition educator side comes out in me. And there are really some very simple steps to take, which might even seem overly simplistic, but they're really not. Finding, you know, sourcing a high-quality multivitamin and mineral supplement for children, too, is extremely important because, you know, when you think about the selective uptake principle, and this is outlined very completely in Sarah Shannon's book, Diet for an Atomic Planet. I want to give her a huge shout out because she did a great job with this research. Selective uptake is simply put when we load and maintain adequate stores of vitamins and minerals in our system, the unhealthy minerals like heavy metals and radionuclides are less likely to be absorbed. So strontium 90 is mistaken for calcium in our bodies. In our bones, it absorbs it. But if we have plenty of healthy calcium in our diet, as much as we can, and in our nutritional supplements, it's going to block the absorption to some degree of the strontium 90. So keeping our health in the best possible condition is so important, and that means eating well, not being afraid, not turning this into fear, because there are some foods that are contaminated, some foods that are not. We need to have the testing in order to know. But right now, myself, I'm avoiding Pacific seafood for obvious reasons. And we have over 400 tons of radioactive wastewater being dumped into the Pacific or more every day from Fukushima. It's basically the big cooling pond for Fukushima right now.
And Kimberly Roberson, we also have the radioactive cloud that was detected here over the West Coast. And even though, you know, the measured levels of it are low enough such that it's not an alarming or alarmist type tendency, the point is that it is there, that it is connected to Fukushima.
Absolutely. And if I may, I'd like to just talk to people about Kelp Watch for a minute, because I'm so glad you brought this up. You know, the only real coverage that this seems to be getting right now is out of Woods Hole, oceanographic lab in Massachusetts. And it seems on the surface to be a very admirable project. It's a crowdfunding project to test for radiation in the ocean. The spokespeople there are not talking about the fact that the plume already got here, you know, 3.5 years ago. So people are thinking, the average person opening up their internet or whatever, they're seeing, oh, well, now they're saying that there's minute amounts detected offshore and it's nothing to worry about. I actually have something that just came out yesterday that was issued by TEPCO, Tokyo Electric and Power Company, issued a statement on Woods Hole report finding very low levels of cesium-134 from Fukushima off California coast. Well, that's great. You know, we don't want the radiation to be in large amounts, obviously, but what we do want is people to know the truth, and it's already here. It's in the topsoil, and it's in the food chain. Kim,
if I can jump in here for just a moment, that people need to understand that there is no dose of radiation below which it is safe to be exposed. This is according to the BEER 7 report, the Biological Effects of Ionizing Radiation, which was put out by the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine, first in 1990, and then it was updated in 2006, so that any radiation we've been exposed to is cumulative over our lifetime, and the sum of small exposures is the same effect as one large exposure. And we never know when we're going to be hitting that tipping point, which is the point where your body is not able to resist the radiation's impact and you do become ill. And one of the absolutely slam dunk known effects of exposure to radiation is the creation of cancer in the body.
We're talking to Libby Halevi, and author and producer of the Nuclear Hotspot, hotseat.com, and then Kimberly Robinson, author and involvement with the Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network. We've been testing now, and they're just simply saying, it's the easiest test to test for cesium-134, and it's been showing up from Alaska now down to our area here in California. But isn't cesium-134 really kind of like a canary in the coal mine? And there's many other isotopes out there. We've already had fallout in the air. So you're talking about the cumulative effects. What's our real danger and worry here?
Well, you're asking such great questions. It's a marker. We don't know absolutely. I couldn't sit here and name every single one. I mean, there are hundreds. You know, let me give you an example. Iodine-131, everyone hears about that one. Half-life of 8 days. Hazardous for how long is it, Libby? A couple of weeks.
That's 8 days, but it has a radiological life of 10 half-life cycles, so it's 80 days, meaning just under 3 months.
80 days, okay. And then you go to iodine-129, which is also part of this toxic mix. That has a half-life of 16 million years. And when I heard that, it would just totally, you know, blew my mind. I mean, Diane DiRico of Nuclear Information Resource Service talked about that at one of our meetings that we had here in California with Senator Feinstein's office 2 or 3 years ago. And that's horrifying to think about. There's no way that we would ever be able to test for all of these radionuclides. What we have to do is hasten to renewable energy as fast as possible. You know, the testing is something that does have to be done, because we would be doing a disservice to future generations if we don't test and find out what's going on with our agricultural situation here. However, we do need to move on to clean energy sources as soon as possible, like they're doing in Germany, because they remember Chernobyl a lot better than we do. So, you know, you've got strontium-90, which is very, you know, it absorbs like calcium in the bones, plutonium-239. Those can both be present with cesium-134 and 137, so it's very safe to assume that those are also there. And then we have, you know, like going to the ENE news site, you'll find all of the other ones that have been removed apparently from the Berkeley site. But fortunately, now that we know the problem, there are things that people can do. And that's where our program comes in at Radiation Awareness Protection Talk, or RAPTAwareness.com. We do have a free report on that website. We really want to encourage your listeners to go there and find this out. There are things that people need to be doing right now. And information is power. We don't want to scare people. This is something that, you know, every generation has its challenges, and this is certainly one that we are dealing with now. But we're optimistic that we can get through it. The awareness around what Fukushima is and other nuclear, I mean, believe me, there are so many others. I know Libby probably talked about that earlier. It's ongoing. I mean, right here in Northern California, we have Lawrence Livermore Labs. Abby Martin did a wonderful report on that last year, that over 1 million curies of radiation has been released there, which is basically the equivalent of the Hiroshima bomb.
Yes, Abby. Abby's on our board at Project Censored, and for those that don't know her program, it's called Breaking the Set on RT.
She's fantastic. You know, this was such a great story to read, and, you know, we have Tri-Valley Cares here in Northern California. I mean, it was a terrible story, obviously, but it was so great that somebody was actually doing the story. And then you have Marilia Kelly at Tri-Valley Cares, her group there that have been working for years to, I think they were successful in helping to block the dumping of radioactive water from Livermore Labs into our watershed up here in Northern California. So in California, people tend to think Diablo, and of course that's a major issue, and San Onofre, but we have many other problems. Levy probably went over WIP and Hanford. Is that right?
Actually, we're going to get into those here in just a moment. We're speaking with Kimberly Roberson and Libby Halevi. We're going to take a short musical break, and we're going to be back to talk about a couple of the issues that you just brought up, maybe even get into a little bit of the lawsuit about the USS Ronald Reagan. We had interviewed Steve Simmons some time ago. Among others, and we want to wrap up again on another positive note. So we'll be right back after this short musical break. To the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. Today's program updates on Fukushima, how nuclear power is an ongoing danger to our health and the environment. Our guests are Libby Halevi, a journalist, and her program NuclearHotSeat.com, also author of a book, Yes, I Glow in the Dark, 1 mile from Three Mile Island to Fukushima and Beyond. We're also joined by Kimberly Roberson, who is one of the founders of Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network, also author of Silence Deafening at SilenceDeafening.com. Silence Deafening, Fukushima Fallout, A Mother's Response. We wanted to turn. We have about, we have maybe about 10 minutes left here to, just to talk about a couple more things. We wanted to talk a little bit about your reactions or response to what was happening with the USS Ronald Reagan. We did a whole show on this because it was a U.S. naval vessel that was in the area when the storms hit and Fukushima happened. And a lot of the people on that vessel were there trying to, you know, they were racing to the area they were in the area, and then they were supposedly trying to help clean up, but a lot of those people were all exposed to this. And the reason we bring that up, and the reason we did a show on that here, is because in the United States, sometimes people don't pay attention to things unless it's happening to Americans. And while we don't see it that way per se, that's a way that people maybe are becoming more aware of this. And now, just recently, there was an approval for the lawsuit to go ahead and to go through regarding that. Do you all want to comment on that?
I will, because I've been following this since the beginning, and I have been in direct contact with the attorneys, Steve Simmons, and some of the other sailors as well. The big win we had in the case was that TEPCO was trying to get it dismissed, and what was just approved was not only the continuation of the case against TEPCO, but the inclusion of four other defendants in the case, General Electric, Ebasco, Toshiba, and Hitachi, which are the four companies that designed and built Fukushima Daiichi to begin with. So this is a huge win because it expands the lawsuit, it moves forward, and it will be going to court within about a year and a half to 2 years. That's the estimation on it. In the meantime, of course, the sailors are desperately ill, and more are joining this course, joining the case every day. There actually has been the first death of a sailor because of this, and there's great denial that this had, that their illnesses have anything to do with radiation, yet that's the only thing that could possibly have caused it, because nothing else had changed in their life except the exposure that they went to on the Reagan.
Kimberly, let's go to you and ask the question. We know now, and you said earlier, that low levels are proven to increase risks of cancer, heart attacks, immune system diseases, miscarriages, birth defects, kind of really terribleness in terms of human health. What parents are listening now, and they haven't realized this, and you talked about taking vitamin supplements and being eating healthy. Can you really expand on that? What is the best thing that we can do to help young people be protected?
Well, filtering drinking water is very important. There are a number of different filters on the market. Natural News just did a series of testing of a bunch of different water filters, and people can check that out online. I don't know if I should be recommending any brands right now on the air or not, but filtering water is really important, and it was kind of upsetting to see at my son's school that above the water fountain there's a quote from, I can't remember the group right now, but it's one of the California science groups saying that, you know, drinking tap water is so much better than bottled. And I always make sure that he takes his water bottle with him, because obviously we have snowpack that melts, that, you know, we still have radiation in the environment from the initial plume coming over, and then it comes down in the rainfall. They're still burning radioactive waste over in Japan right now. So we tried to get them to stop that. There was a big worldwide petition 2 years ago, and we did other things, and the government was just going to go ahead and continue to burn. So it's not over yet. There are alternatives to milk. I think one of the big problems over in Belarus was everybody drinking milk, and a lot of health problems happened because of that. So we can learn that lesson to sourcing the child's beverages more wisely. You know, let's put it that way. And then really avoiding, I would avoid seafood right now myself. I can only say what I'm doing. The thing with kids, they're so much more prone to genetic problems because of this, because their cells are dividing rapidly. And so they're the ones that we really, really have to worry about. Of course, the caregivers have to be okay. But even some of the vitamins that I've seen on shelves will source omega-3s from tuna, and iodine from kelp. And those are two major things to avoid right now.
Those are bigger issues, bigger sea life, or bigger issues. Kimberly, when you were mentioning the business about water, I believe that was referring to drinking tap water versus bottled water, as in branded bottled water, like Nestle or what have you. In your case, you were talking about filtered water, but in that case, they're talking about, because there are far fewer tests or filters done on some of the bottled water brands. But in your case, you're literally talking about bringing it from home, from your own filter.
Exactly.
Right.
And surprisingly, Nestle, I mean, for all of the stuff they can be associated with that may be negative in the past, they are doing some of the best, if not the best, bottled water testing right now. And they'll put their findings on their product, which most other companies won't do. So I know people that insist on having that particular brand brought into their home, delivered, using that, finding that when they're out and about, and they don't have their own bottled water or their own filtered water with them. But you can buy,
which is clearly the best bet, doing it yourself.
Right, right. You can, like, if you're out in a pinch and you need something, but you can actually buy Brita filter bottles, mm-hmm. small bottles, and fill for children. That's a charcoal activated bottle. There are some water filtration companies that go a little further. Some that, you know, Life Water is one that will remove pretty much everything, all of the TDS, the total dissolved solids. What that also means, all the more reason to take your multivitamin and mineral supplement, emphasis on mineral, because it has an ionization filter, so it'll also remove the healthy minerals from the water. And so that's important to know. We have to. That's why that multivitamin and mineral vitamin supplement is so important. It seems so easy, but it's really important.
Libby Halevi, let's go back to you. We only have 2 minutes left in the program, unfortunately. We'll definitely have to hit this issue again. We've done it so many times. times, but it's so important to talk about these things. Let's just have you give us the last couple minutes, sort of a roundup, some things you want people to take away, and some proactive measures people, again, could be taking from your vantage point.
I think that what Kim was talking about in terms of health preservation is really important, because this is something she and I have both been focusing on for the better part of this year. And I want to reiterate that we have a free report available to people on a site that is called wrappedawareness.com. Wrapped stands for Radiation Awareness and Protection Talk, because we put together a program for people to understand what they need to know to do their best job possible in preserving their health, where we do go over water purification, air purification, food choices, etc. And this is our attempt to get information to people so that they can preserve their health. Beyond that, we need people to get involved. The best way to get out of the inaction and the denial, really, the stages of grief, but everybody seems stuck in denial right now about how bad it is over in Fukushima and around the rest of the country. We didn't get a chance to talk about the accidents that are ongoing right now at the WIPP site in Carlsbad and at Metropolis, the uranium spill at in Metropolis, Illinois.
Yeah, that's another whole show. We'll have to do that.
We will, and I'll come on for that. Okay. But here's the thing. People need to take one action a day. Don't overload yourself, but read a report. Listen to Nuclear Hot Seat. Google local groups or groups in your state and find one that's there. Go to a website. Read a report. Have a conversation with someone about this. Don't be alone with it, and realize that there is not only a local but a national and an international movement that's fighting against this, that's been making tremendous inroads through lawsuits, through actions we've taken, through information. And for any reporters who might be listening to this, there are Pulitzers hidden in these stories in every local community. So just go out and get them, because this is a story that does not end.
Libby Halevi, thank you so much for your work and for joining us today. NuclearHotSeat.com, also Wrapped Awareness, RAPTAwareness.com. Kimberly Roberson, Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network, thank you so much for joining us on the Project Censored Show today.
Thank you so much.
Here's Peter Phillips.
My pleasure.
Thanks so much. Peter?
Well, yeah, we're reminded that November this year is the 25th anniversary of the El Salvador massacres of the Jesuit priests and their housekeeper. And there's going to be an anniversary march and protest from at the School of Americas down in Georgia on November 21, 23, for those not down at Fort Benning. So that's ongoing right now. But for those who aren't their way all the way to Georgia already, there's a couple of events happening in the Bay Area. Tonight, there's a No Impunity in El Salvador, Mexico, San Francisco vigil memorial of the martyr Jesuits and the two women in El Salvador. It's at Mission and 24th Street from 5:30 to 7. For information, call 415-338-7584. On the University of San Francisco on Sunday, there's a memorial mass for the martyrs of the El Salvador massacre, and that's in a vigil procession. If the mass is at 6 o'clock and the vigil march is at 7:30 on campus there. Tonight in Santa Rosa, there's a documentary film, The Nuclear Savage, which is about Marshall Islanders who were used as guinea pigs for 3 decades to study the effects of nuclear fallout on human beings. Very powerful movie. I showed it in class last month. That's November 21st, 7 p.m. at the Santa Rosa Junior College. It's a free showing. So that's next week. November 22nd, Saturday, there's the Drop Beats Not Bombs Dub Music Benefit for the Western States Legal Foundation. And it's at the Arlene Francis Center in Santa Rosa. Features Professor Shiab, father of Middle Eastern Dab and local Dab artist Schlump and Selby. All ages invited.
You've been tuned to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. Special thanks to Robert Manning today for our program, Fukushima Updates, Nuclear Power and Ongoing Danger to Our Health and Environment. Special thanks to Junkyard Empire for our theme, We Want. Thanks to Erica Bridgman at the controls. Also to Anthony Fest, our producer. The Project Censored Show airs weekly out of Berkeley, California on KPFA. Airs on 20 stations around the United States. Please learn more about our work at projectcensored.org. Please follow and like us on Facebook. Stay tuned now for Terra Verde, and tune in next week as Peter Phillips and I will have Peter Dale Scott for the hour talking about the deep state. See?
But my people getting tired of the pain and the shame. We're not commodities or cogs that turn to global economy. We're the promise of a legacy, a spirit we're honoring. An anomaly to those who can't imagine a world without oppressive forces slaving for a mighty dollar bill.
La Pena invites you to the premiere of Unplugged, directed and performed by NPR storyteller and TED speaker Joshua Walters. Unplugged will run for one night only and poses the question, what if everyone in the world stopped using technology for one day? Layering improv, music, and comedy, the Unplugged experience will transport the audience to different time periods. The event takes place on Saturday, November 22nd at 7:30 p.m. at La Pena Cultural Center, 3105 Shattuck Avenue in Berkeley, and proceeds will help support La Pena's work with arts and social justice in the Bay and beyond. Unplugged has been commissioned by the La Pena Cultural Center with support from National Performance Network. For more information, visit www.lapena.org or call 510-849-2567.